Okay, good morning, everybody. Well, as Jose has said, I've been working, I work in CRISA for 20 years now, and I've been working in electrical propulsion for 15 years. In PPUs, mainly for gridded ion engines, so my presentation is going to be focused mainly in gridded ion engines, electronics for gridded ion engines. So, in any case, I will go slowly to the matter of the electronics. I will present first a bit the company, just to encourage you to join us in the future. Then we will see some basic electric propulsion concepts that José Antonio has already gone through them in the first presentation. And then we will go through the different electric propulsion elements that we can find in an electric propulsion system, how an electrostatic thruster operates, and more specifically, an ion-gridded thruster, ion-gridded engine. And then we will see how the PPUs, the power processing units, are, what are the functions that they usually have, and also what are the design keys for the electronics of a PPU. And finally, we will see some examples of missions for which we have developed PPUs for flight. So, CRISA. CRISA stands for Computadoras, Redes e Ingeniería, nothing to do with space business, but we have been, or we are today a subsidiary of Airbus Defense and Space. We work for space, and we have been working in the space for 30 years now. We are located in Tres Cantos, in the north of Madrid. We are more than 400 employees, qualified employees, in fact. And we have delivered up to now more than 800 units, flight units. And up to now, we have had no failures in flight reported. And well, our main activity is everything related with the space business. Electronic units for launchers, platforms, science, telecom, everything. So we mainly work in four different product lines, one for launchers. We design and manufacture avionics for launchers, electronics for launchers. In the range of power products, we provide units for power conditioning of platforms and spacecrafts in general, DC-DC converters, power subsystem, of course, power propulsion units. For payloads, we propose, we design and provide control electronics for instruments, security units, cooler, front-end video, data processing, and so on, and same for platform also, onboard computers, control momentum gyros, thermal control units, pyrotechnic, the electronic control devices, and so on. And within these areas, we also provide for the ground segment ground control or mission for mission control centers and access for ground testing of units and ground acceptance of units. This is some of the types of applications that we have for payload or platform, for which we have designed some examples of units. For example, for payloads, is this, oops, working? Yeah. No. Okay, for payloads, for example, we have we provide instrument controllers, digital signal processors, proximity and video electronics, driving electronics for motors, for example, for deploying antennas, and active antennas electronics. And for platforms, we provide also data handling, power, electric propulsion units, onboard computers, and driving electronics, and so on. So now we go to the electric propulsion concept. First, two basic concepts. Well, something that Jose has explained also before, that is the two key parameters, and we have also seen in the other presentation, the two key parameters to, let's say, compare propulsion system. The first one is the thrust. This is the force that the engine is able to provide to the platform. And the second one is the specific impulse. Another way to see what is the specific impulse is the efficiency of the thruster using the propellant. So for a different thrusters, if you have the same amount of propellant and you are providing the same thrust, how long the propellant is going to last you. So if we go, for example, we compare with a car, this is for a car with a given power and running at a given speed with the same amount of fuel, how many kilometers are you going to be able to run? That is what the specific impulse gives. Although the units are a bit strange, it's seconds, but okay. There is another important point for, specifically this is for electric propulsion system, is a key parameter also, but this is more than a key parameter to compare, is a limiting factor too. Is that at the end, electric propulsion systems consist in taking ionized gas and accelerate with electrical power. The problem here is the electrical power. The electrical power in a spacecraft is quite limited. We cannot have as much electrical power as we want. It's limited. In the higher power spacecraft that we have now, it can be in the range of 15 kilowatts, but it's usually even lower than that. So that means that we cannot provide as much thrust as we would like. Even a part of the limitations of the thruster itself that are not developed today to provide so high thrust, but the fact is that the power that is available does not allow to reach more than hundreds of millinewtons of thrust. We cannot go farther. So it is also an important parameter for the system, the ratio between the thrust that you are providing and the power that is required to provide that thrust. In this table, we can compare, more or less, is something that we have done before, the engine of a specific, rocket, solid rocket, typical solid rocket, and an ion thruster. The exhaust velocity is 10 times higher, usually, or typically, and the specific impulse, it can be also 10 times higher for the ion thruster. So, the advantages of the electric propulsion, that this is something that we have already gone through, is the very high exhaust speed, that at the end means that you have a high specific impulse and then fuel mass savings, that is what operators are interested in, and the very high specific impulse, that is tiny. And the main drawback is the thrust that you can obtain, that is very low, because you have not enough electrical power to get very high thrust. So what are the typical applications? Typical applications of electrical propulsion are then station keeping maneuvers. So this is to keep the spacecraft in the orbit that you want to have it. Deep space scientific missions also, as for example the BepI Colombo that we have already mentioned, or others, where you do not have a limitation in time. So you can save mass by having a very, very long duration travel. And also orbit racing, that is something that is being done now, but it has the drawback that it takes much more time than with the chemical propulsion. So these are the typical elements that we can find in an electric propulsion system. I have not included here the xenon tank because in some cases it can be also used by other systems, not only for electric propulsion. But it could be inside this. I consider that the electric propulsion system is built of the high pressure regulator that is at the end a set of valves that are able to reduce the pressure of the xenon that is stored in the tank to a value or a pressure that is usable by the thruster. Then the typical flow control unit that controls the amount of xenon that is delivered to the thruster. The thruster itself, I call here thruster assembly because at the end the thruster, let's say we can consider it has two different parts, the thruster itself that generates the thrust and also the neutralizer. So all together is usually called thruster, but it's like an assembly of two things. And of course the power processing unit. In many cases, the high pressure regulator and the flow control unit can be all together in a single unit. And the links of this system with the platform at the end are the propellant, the propellant heat pipes for the high pressure regulator, between the high pressure regulator and the xenon tank, and the power link with the power processing unit and the control, the TMTC control of the power processing unit that is usually connected to the onboard computer. In some cases, also the high pressure regulator has is controlled by the onboard computer directly, and then you need another TMTC link with the onboard computer with this part. So, in detail, the high pressure regulator is used for that. It's between the thruster or the flow control unit and the xenon tank, and it's used to reduce the pressure, basically, and keep it within a level that is useful for the AP system. And it can be controlled either by the power processing unit directly or by the onboard computer. That is, in cases where xenon is used for other purposes, then it's more logical to be directly controlled by the onboard computer. And it's, in fact, usually do it this way. Then the flow control unit, or xenon flow control unit, is the unit that is in charge of taking this xenon coming from the high pressure regulator and deliver to the thruster. And also, well, when I say the thruster, I mean now the complete thruster assembly. So we are there are part of the xenon that is delivered to the thruster, to the chamber that generates the thrust, and there is another part that is delivered to the neutralizer to get the discharge and the plasma required to deliver the stream of electrons required in the neutralization process. And this unit is usually controlled by the PPU directly because it's quite related. The operation of the complete electrical propulsion system and the thruster is quite related to how the flow control unit has to be operated. So usually the PPU is in charge of controlling both parts or both units. And if you see one of these flow controllers, so the one in the picture is basically a very complex thin of plumbing. You have valves, you have flow restrictors. Flow restrictors are usually mechanical, magnetical, thermal, there are different types. You can have also some types of monitoring, monitor pressure, monitor temperature. And all these things are usually controlled by the PPU. And then we have the thruster assembly. This is what okay, so this is what I call thruster itself because it's the chamber where the xenon is injected, it's ionized and it's expelled, and this is what it really generates the thrust. But this is the neutralizer that delivers the stream of electrons that is required to neutralize the plasma once it's in space. And the assembly is usually delivered together. This is an example of or a picture of the T5 thruster by Kinetic. That is one of the ones for which we deliver PPUs. And then we have the power processing unit, the PPU. Here we have, for example, the picture of the PPU that was delivered to drive that thruster, the T5. The basic function of the PPU at the end is to take the power from the power bus of the spacecraft and deliver the controlled power to the different elements that have to be supplied in the flow controller unit and in the thruster, in both in the chamber, different elements of the chamber, and also the neutralizer itself. That is the main function. Take the power, transfer the power, and deliver the power as it is required by these elements. But the fact is that at the end, in the PPU is included other things, as for example, the complete monitoring of the system is usually performed by the PPU. The intelligence required to drive properly the complete system, so start up the thruster, switch off the thruster, and everything that is required. Of course, as it has the monitoring of the system in case that something fails, a protection triggers, or something happens, something is abnormal, some monitor parameter is abnormal. The PPU usually have to take the actions and to decide what to do. Restart the system or advise the onboard computer and switch off the system. So at the end, it has a lot of electronics included within. It's the brain of the system, and the final goal usually for any platform is to have a PPU for which the onboard computer, the only thing that had to say is switch on the system, switch on the EP, and the BPU is in charge of controlling everything related to the propulsion and switch off when it is required, and that's all. And only in case of, let's say, catastrophic failure where the PPU is not able to solve or is something that is completely abnormal, it's not, let's say, prepared for that, then the onboard computer is advised and probably you have to report to Earth and from ground you have to take the decision of what to do with the system. But the autonomy of the system is one of the main goals. So how an electrostatic thruster operates? I'm going to focus, as I have said before, in the ion-gridded thruster, but this is general for any electrostatic thruster. At the end, there are three stages. In some cases, there are two of them that are mixed. But we have one first stage that is the ionization of the propellant that is made within the chamber of the thruster. The, usually the fuel that is used is xenon because it has a very low value required for the ionization. Then once you have within the chamber these ions, positive ions, a mix of positive ions and electrons, this plasma, when this you need to accelerate the ions, the positive ions, to the exhaust velocity when they are expelled from the thruster, generating the thrust. And there is a final stage that is the neutralization of the ions. You have to provide an equivalent amount of electrons than positive ions. This is necessary because you have to avoid, first, you cannot leave plasma charged in the space, but if you charge the plasma, you also charge the spacecraft in the opposite potential. So to keep everything neutral at the end, you need to expel as much ions as positive ions as electrons. And that is the third part of the process. So what makes the electrostatic thrusters, let's say, different of others is how the thruster accelerate the positive ions. For that, what it is used in the electrostatic thrusters is an electric field. Once we have generated the plasma within the thruster and we have the positive ions, when the positive ions are close to this electric field, they are, let's say, attracted by the field and are accelerated through the field and are exhausted out of the thruster. So that is the main difference with other type of thrusters. Why these are electrostatic? Because they use an electrostatic electrical field to accelerate the ions. Difference between electrostatic thrusters are due to how this electric field is generated. In a gridded ion, for example, is generated by placing two different grids at different potentials, and then the ions that enter within these grids are accelerated and expelled out of the second grid. And there can be also differences on how the ionization process is done. Specifically, in the gridded ion thruster, this is the case where we have two grids at the output. We have the chamber, the complete assembly of the chamber, and this first grid is at a given potential, positive and usually very high in the range of 1 to 2 kilovolts. And then we have another grid that is usually below zero volts. And then this is the electrical field between these grids. You have the electrical field when this red ions, positive ions approach to this grid, they are extracted and accelerated between these two grids and are expelled. The ionization process, even for gridded ions, may be different. There are cases in which the ionization process is done with electrons bombardment, placing a cathode within the chamber. Or it can be also done with radio frequency, as we have also learned in the previous presentations. So the power processing unit. At the end, the power processing unit has to control all these different elements. So we can divide the power processing unit, and I would say any power processing unit, independently of the type of thruster that is going to drive, in four specific functionalities. The first one is the control. It's clear that the control is used to communicate with the platform and take the control of all the things. It's basically, let's say, something digital. Then the elements required, the supplies or whatever element that you require to control the flow control unit. A set of supplies that are used to control the neutralizer elements, the elements that are within the neutralizer. And then there are a fourth block that is the supplies that are used to drive and to energize the different elements that are part of the chamber of the thruster itself. So concerning the control, this is, let's say, the brain of the complete EP system. It has to take in charge the communication with the platform. It has to receive telecommands from the platform and execute them. It has to verify also that these commands are correct, that there are no problems, or you are not commanding something that is going to be a problem for the EP system because you have commanded something erroneous, or because you are commanding something that is not erroneous by itself, but is erroneous if you check what you have previously commanded, and so on. It has also to execute the sequencing that is required by the thruster to be switched on and to be switched off to control the FCU. It usually contains also the loop that is required to control stable the thrust, because usually when you have the thruster already started and you reach a thrust level, you need to monitor some parameters of the system, and with these parameters you have to retrofit and change the values of other parameters, that the ones that you are able to control, to keep the thrust constant and avoid drifts in the thrust. And the, that control loop is usually also performed by this control. And of course, you have to monitor as much parameters as possible, temperatures, pressures, voltages, currents, whatever is required by the system. And in case something is abnormal, it takes the decision to what to do with that abnormality. We have to switch off the thruster and restart again. We have to just stop and wait for the onboard computer and say to the onboard computer to take a decision by itself or whatever. The PPU or the control in the PPU is usually performed either with microprocessors or with FPGA. The tendency is to use FPGAs, basically, because are a bit cheaper. But it depends mainly on the flexibility that is required by the system. Well, we know that microprocessors in general are more flexible than FPGAs, that once you have burned it, you lose the possibility to change anything except if you make it a bit more complex. So this is an example of one control board. This in particular is the control board for the T6. This is the control board just for one T6 by Kinetic. It's a 5 kilowatts thruster with many elements. And this is the, in this case, for example, it is used an FPGA. This is the FPGA that has the brain of the complete system. This is part of the PPU delivered for the BEPI mission, BEPI Colombo mission. So what about the FCU supplies? Okay, well, we have seen before that the FCU usually contains elements at valves, heaters, restrictors, flow restrictors. It can also have some type of pressure sensors, temperature sensors, so on. So this part of the unit have to drive all these elements at the valves and so on and command it according to what the FPGA or the control says that they have to do. But it has to monitor also the different parameters and report to the onboard computer. There are many different types of FCUs, many types of valves, many types of flow restrictors, and we can say that there is no universal approach for these elements. So you can find valves or restrictors that requires a DC voltage to be driven, or a DC current, or maybe some strange pattern of voltage or current, different values, in some cases very low currents, in other cases very high powers. So you, at the end, this block of the power supply, of this block of the PPU, depends on what you have in the FCU and can have different type of electronics. A simple approach that is used whenever it's possible, because it's very low cost, is to have a single DC voltage power supply and then a set of different switches that are controlled by the FPGA. So you use this power supply controlled by the FPGA in pulse width modulated mode to provide an average value of a controlled average voltage value to the different units. This is a simple way to do it because you only need at the end a DC voltage supply that is quite simple to find, to design, etc. And FPGA that you already have in the system for controlling everything that is in charge of providing the control of the different switches. Furthermore, the FPGA allow to provide a, let's say, strange or complex pattern to control this voltage if it's necessary. This is a simple approach, the simplest, say, and the one that is followed
as when it is possible. Not always it is possible. In the previous picture that we have seen, the control board, for example, as part of the control board, it was integrated also the FCU driving. The FCU driving is this part, and it includes, is based in the approach that I have explained of having a DC voltage power supply and then switches controlled by the FPGA. One of the reasons to have it in this board is to have all these switches quite close to the FPGA, not very far. If you have enough space, there is no problem to place it there. And typical figures of driving for the valves, usually all the valves and flow restrictors are below 32 volts, 28 volts is a typical figure, and below 0.5 amps. Although you can find in some cases things strange as having 10 volts and 5 amps, for example. It's not impossible. So the neutralizer supplies block. Well, what is a neutralizer? At the end, a neutralizer is a cathode that has to be supplied with a small amount of xenon so that you can get plasma without in the closed area of the neutralizer to have electrons free that are able to be attracted by the positive ions that you are expelling and then neutralize the plasma that is outside the thruster. This cathode requires first to be heated to start to deliver electrons, and then once the plasma is formed, then you need to keep this plasma in discharge, and that requires a constant current. So in principle, you need two power supplies to perform this function. The first one to supply the heater is usually a current, a DC current power supply, not very complex, to provide a DC current to an element that is basically a resistor. It's easy. And then you have another power supply that is the keeper supply that has to power the cathode when it is in discharge mode. In this case, the thing is a little bit more complex. The amount of current may be similar, the voltage required may be similar too. But the problem is that now the load is not a simple resistor, but is plasma. And plasma is a bad guy. If you see it as a load for electronics. And there is additionally another issue is that sometimes, even when you already have some electrons that are being delivered, to start the discharge process in the cathode, you need to apply high voltage pulses to start up the discharge process. These high voltage pulses are usually in the range of hundreds of volts, 300 volts, 400 volts, and usually they are very short pulses, and this is not easy or not so easy to generate. These are some typical driving figures for cathodes, is voltages below 15 volts and currents below 5 amps. For both, the heater supply and the keeper supply are usually these limitations, let's say, or these limits are the considered, and the initial pulses for the keeper supply are usually in the range of 300 to 500 volts easily, and at least the current is not very low, in the range of hundreds of milliamps. Then we have the thruster supplies. Well, in particular, to supply the chamber, we need at least two power supplies. For sure. The first one is what we call beam supply or positive high voltage supply that is in charge of providing the voltage to the complete chamber assembly and to the first grid. And then we need another power supply, usually we call it accelerator supply, that is in charge of providing the negative voltage to the accelerator grid. Okay. So you need at least this. These power supplies both are high voltage, although this one is usually much more, the bin supply is usually much more high voltage than this one, but both are high voltage at the end. Both are DC voltage supplies, both have as load plasma, what is, let's say, a problem because the implications of having plasma as load for the design of the power supplies. And the bin supply in particular is the power supply that has to manage most of the power of the PPU. Usually is 80 to 90% of the power that is handled by a PPU is delivered by this power supply. So if we talk about 5 kilowatts thruster, usually this is in the range of 4 kilowatts is delivered by this power supply that has to deliver very high power and usually high voltage, very high voltage. These are typical driving figures for the bin supply, 1 to 2 kilovolts, and for the accelerator, it can be in that range, negative 250 to 1 kilovolt. But the only advantage is for the accelerator supply that is, at the end, is low power because the current that is delivered is very low. There are other thruster supplies that I have not mentioned here because are those that are dedicated to the ionization process within the chamber. And that depends on the type of thruster. This can be, in the case, for example, of the ionization process is based in electron bombardment, having an internal cathode, it can be required power supplies to supply that cathode, quite similar to the neutralizer then. You need a heater and a keeper and so on. You can need, in the case of the gridded ion, the Kaufman-type gridded ions, where you have the magnetic field that you have to control, you need a power supply to control that magnetic field. But for other thrusters, radio frequency thrusters, the red thruster, for example, what you need is something to generate a radio high frequency electromagnetic field within the chamber, and then you need another type of supplies. So all these supplies required for the initiation process would be included also within this set of power supplies. Okay, what are the design keys, or I would say the problems that we found when we design a PPU? Well, the main are the loads characterization and the simulation, because, well, I explain later on, the grounding, the high voltage management of the system, or the PPU in particular, thermal issues, and the testing of the unit. What happened with the loads? Well, for those cases as the power supplies that are driving heaters, it is quite easy to design the power supply because at the end a heater is a resistor, and a resistor is quite easy to simulate, to analyze. You have mathematical models, and that's all. It's quite easy. But most of the power supplies in a PPU have as load plasma, and plasma, as I have said before, is a bad guy. It is let's say quite unknown in the terms of that we do not have reliable, at least for this type of thruster, we do not have reliable mathematical models to know what is the behavior of the plasma. So we cannot design in front of mathematical models the power supply. We have to almost adivinate what is the behavior. We are always basing in the heritage that we have, and at the end, as you do not have these mathematical models to allow a easy design of the power supply, the only way that you have to check your power supplies once they are designed against the load is to validate with the load itself. There is no way to do it in other way. You need to use the thruster. It's the only way to validate your design, to test your design, and to adjust your design. Grounding. Okay, this is another issue that is a bit complex. The electric propulsion systems have a specific grounding. Usually in a spacecraft, all the power not only the power, but all the units in a spacecraft system are usually referenced to the spacecraft ground, like here, our ground, okay? And when everything is referenced to the same reference ground, things are easy. You do not have big potentials between them, and things are quite easy. But in the electric propulsion system, this is not this way. You have first the control and the sub, and the flow controller unit, and the control part of the PPU are both referenced to the platform ground, usually. This allows an easy connection with the onboard computer and with the power conditioning unit of the platform that are at the same potential. But then, for the operation of the thruster, you need to have the different supplies that supply or drives the neutralizer and the thruster floating. They cannot be referenced to the platform ground. They have to be floating, and this the potential of this floating line can be changed. Well, it can be a DC value that can change from tens to hundreds of volts, and AC value and transients that can be also in the range, in that range of tens to hundreds of volts. Of course, we cannot allow that this potential go as far as he wants. So we have to place always a clamping device to assure that at least we keep it without the limit that the electronics are designed to withstand. And if the potential of that line goes out of the limits that the units are designed to withstand, then typically the reaction is switch off the system and advise the onboard computer that something is wrong. But the problem here is that at the end you have, okay, this is not a problem, but the control at the end, you have the all the control of the unit references to this point, but this control have to control these functions. And if you have this control referenced to this ground, and you have this function floating, and maybe 100 volts over this one, or tens of volts over this one, then the communication is not easy. So one of the main issues is how to communicate these points. And it's usually done using either optical links or magnetic links, transformers, optocouplers, or maybe other optical links, even. Well, additionally, another point that is also is part of this, is not directly related with the ground, but with the thruster itself, is that in the operation of the thruster, the thrusters are quite noisy. The plasma behavior is quite noisy. It produces a lot of transients, usually transients or noise in the range of tens of kilohertz. And all this noise, of course, is not only here. Transmitted through the harness, through the different elements of the unit, so you have to filter, you have to withstand these transients, and you have to assure that even under these noisy conditions, all the unit is able to work and to operate and is not going to be set up. So another key that is quite important, especially when we talk about gridded ion thrusters, due to the high voltages that they have to manage, is how do we manage this high voltage? Okay, this is the typical passing curve that gives us the relationship between the breakdown voltage, in this case if for the air, as relation of the pressure. Okay. When you reduce the pressure of the air, as far as you reduce the pressure, the dielectric voltage falls. Reach a minimum that is in the range of 10 to 100 pascals. And once you have, you continue going to vacuum and you go to very high vacuum, then the dielectric rigidity again increases. But the problem is that here we are in the range of 300 volts, more or less. It depends on different factors, but it's in the range of 250, 300 volts. And our units are usually in the range of kilovolts, 1 kilovolt, 2 kilovolt. So we are usually in this area, okay? So with these voltages, we have one problem with the partial, this is what we call partial pressure, that in principle we cannot be there, or if we have to go through this area, through this minimum, we have to provide a way to withstand this minimum. And there is another effect that once you have passed this and go to high vacuum, There is another effect that is the triple junction. Triple junction is an effect that happens when you have a potential or a conductor with a potential is in contact with an isolator material, isolation material, and vacuum. In that case, is let's say easy, depends on many factors, but it is easy for the electrons to start to jump through the surface of the isolator. And at the end, you can have something like a corona effect or arcing or whatever. So we have to take also into account this to in the designs to be sure that they are not going to affect the design. So what are the solutions that are usually used? One of them is high voltage potting. This is high voltage potting. So here you can see this is a module with high voltage potting. This module is basically just a transformer. This is a transformer and a set of rectifiers. Okay. The rectifiers are in the secondary side of the transformer. The primary side of the transformer is connected to chassis ground, so it's not an issue. But the secondary side and the rectifiers are connected to a very high potential. In fact, this is for 2 kilovolts. So the transformer has to isolate that 2 kilovolts within the transformer. And furthermore, all the elements that are here are referenced to 2 kilovolts, while this mechanical elements that is aluminium is the assembly of the unit is referenced also to ground. So you are going to have the 2 kilovolts between these elements and the structure of the unit. You have to isolate all these things. And the way to do it in this case is applying high voltage potting. High voltage potting is basically this a plastic material, is an epoxy that is applied following several different processes of high vacuum, high pressure, so that you have this brick of plastic. This is really a brick without bubbles within the brick, because otherwise you can have also internal effects affecting the isolation. And well, this is one of the ways to do it. It has some advantages. One of them is that it's able to withstand partial pressure. You do not have here, when you lose pressure, this block is always, let's say, surrounded by the plastic, so it's not affected by what is happening outside the block. And there is another good issue, or good point for this, is that it's not affected by triple junction effect, because at the end what you have here is the potential or the conductor parts that are a high potential are directly within the isolation material. There is no places where you have together the isolation material with the conductor and vacuum. So you solve two of the points that were, let's say, a problem. But it has also some drawbacks. The first one is that whatever it happens inside this, if something is broken, you cannot repair. Well, not completely through. Sometimes it can be repaired, but is not usual. When there are small problems in the surface and so on, sometimes you can repair, or maybe if you have a problem here in this case, you can detach from this part, but reparations in this type of things, most of the times are not possible, and when they are possible, are very costly. Another issue is that it has a very poor thermal behavior. Usually, the epoxy that is used to isolate or to get the electrical insulation also provides thermal insulation. And this is not good because usually you have a lot of dissipation in these modules, so you have to extract that power somewhere. So the mechanical design of the thermal design, is very complex to be sure that a part of the electrical insulation you are able to extract of the dissipation from the module. Another issue is the high cost, and another problem or another drawback is that it's quite massive. This can have a mass of close to 2 kilograms. Another way to do or to get the electrical insulation for high voltage is this. In this case, this is what we call an open design. It's basically in half enough distance between two potentials. In this case, we have all that is within this grid, and this, there is an electronic board within, everything is at high voltage, and then we have the external layer is what is referenced to ground. And in between, we have, in this case, our ceramic isolators to keep the distance between these two layers. So if you have enough distance between these two layers, you are able also to withstand the high voltage between the two potentials. But of course, we have, again, advantages. This is less massive than the potting. You can repair because you can disassembly this, dismount, assembly again. And the thermal behavior of this is usually better than the thermal behavior of the plastic brick. But we have also the drawbacks that this is not able to withstand partial pressure because it's submitted, in fact, to partial pressure if you go through that minimum with this unit switched on, and it's affected by triple junction. So in the places as this one where you have the potential together with the isolator and vacuum, when you have already vacuum established, you have to take a very careful design because otherwise you are going to have problems or corona effect or arcing in these areas. So the design is quite complex. And at the end, due to this complexity in the design and the material that you have to use, is also a high cost solution. So what we can basically, let's say in summary, obtain from this is that the high voltage management in any case has high cost. There is no other way to do it. Then we have thermal issues, and this is basically because what I have commented before, any solution that you take to improve or to get very high insulation, electrical insulation, usually leads also to thermal insulation. In the case of the plastic, is clear. In the case of the ceramic materials, in the open design solution, ceramics can be good for thermal conductance, but you have to place a lot of them or a lot of surface of ceramic to allow this thermal conductance, and then you have other problems that these ceramic materials are less robust when you go to mechanical issues, for example, vibrations that you have to withstand during the launch of the launcher and so on. So it has other problems. But in general, let's say that high voltage insulation leads to thermal problems too. Sorry. And then the testing. As I have said before, the problem is the load behavior is that is extremely complex. So at the end, to validate your unit, to validate your electronics, to refine the adjustments, you have to test together with the real load. This is with the thruster. And a thruster does not work in the lab. It's working in the lab within a specific vacuum chamber that has to be specifically, let's say, designed or built to test that thruster and so on. The amount of facilities to do that are limited. You cannot do it anywhere. You cannot use any vacuum chamber. And these tests are very expensive. You need to go there with your electronics, connect to the thruster. The vacuum operation of the chamber is quite complex. If you have any problem and you have to see something, you cannot see it because the thruster is within the chamber. So it's really very expensive, and there is no other way to test the electronics. And some examples of missions, well, this José Antonio has also explained before, Goche and Bepi, so as I am running out of time, we'll go directly to the PPU itself. This is the PPU that was delivered for the Goche mission. It was called, in this case, Ion Propulsion Control Unit, IPCU. This was in the range of less than 1 kilowatt, in fact, 700 watts, with a voltage, working at a voltage of 1.2 kilovolts, and the mass of this unit was 17 kilograms. In this case, we use a mix of open design concept and high voltage potted modules, depending on the use. We use one of them. This is the aspect of the unit when it is open, and this is when it is delivered and closed. And then the Goche mission, that is the potato that is represented or is obtained with the measurements of the Goche. And well, this is the goal that has been explained before. Here we use 46 thrusters. This is also the assembly, and this is the unit. This is the PPU that has been delivered for this. This is a very specific unit for this mission. It was required a very specific unit with complete redundancy to assure that in case of single failure, the unit is going to be able to continue working because it's connected to four thrusters, and you are able to select what is the thruster that you want to drive, and has to be able to do it even after a first failure. In this case, the unit is able to deliver 5 kilowatts to a single thruster, a single T6 thruster, and it operates at a voltage that is in the range of the 2 kilovolts, is 1.85 kilowatts. The total mass of this unit, and excluding this base big base of aluminium. Only what is the unit is 47 kilograms. So the mass is high, but it's mainly due to the fact that here we have almost, let's say, two units together. And I think that's all. Yes, that's all. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much, Javier. We are a little bit tight on time, but we have time for a couple of questions. There is any question?
Now, Kinetic, they actually at least have on market the T5 simulator, as far as I read some papers, but how realistic is this?
That's a question for Kinetic.
I mean, during the development of PPUs, are you using...
During the development of the PPU for the T5, that was made, well, 10 years ago, and we didn't have that simulator for the thruster. Okay. So we use heritage they have. Of course, what they have is a lot of information on how is the behavior of the thruster with when they drive the thruster with a ground testing unit, with low power supplies, that's true. But that provides some information on what are the type of the transients and behaviors that we can expect, the frequencies, amplitudes, and so on, that we can expect at the output of the, or at the links between the PPU and the thruster. That gives us some clues to develop and to design the unit. But it's true that when you change the power supplies, as the power supplies are different, have different behavior, have different frequency bandwidth, have different filtering, the behavior is not always the same that what you have obtained with lab power supplies. But it's an initial important, let's say, evidence of what to do. Yeah.
Okay. Any other question? I have a small question. What do you think about relays? And what do you think about the solid-state relays?
Well, about relays, in fact, for high voltage, we have used in this mission, you know, mission for Bepi Colombo, we have a lot of relays and we have had a lot of problems with the relays, basically because they are not specifically qualified for flight. They are qualified, but not in the same conditions that are used in space. They are, so, and there are no other relays than the ones that we have used for this mission. So, in my opinion, it's better to avoid them in the designs. It's clear. I have to say also that it's not only, or this problem of qualification is not only for the relays. When we take a component that is qualified for space, it has gone through several different types of screening and testing to be qualified, but usually they are not done even when they are used for high voltage. The screening that they have to pass or the qualification that they have to pass is not made in real vacuum conditions. So sometimes the behavior that we expect when we submit together or we have together the high voltage and the vacuum is not the same than the qualification at high voltage that does not use vacuum.
Okay. Thank you very much, Javier.